specifically focused on enterprise tax benefits and various employee allowances. So I'll, before I go into that, I just want to have a general understanding of my audience here. Okay, how many of you have ever tried doing something related to payments, whatever may it be, like, you know, building something related to payments? Okay, a few. Okay, that's great. Okay, so is it predominantly card acceptance, payment gateways, or stuff like that? Okay, so great. So I come from the other side, okay, not on the payment receiving side, but creating payment instruments that people could use to make payments, right? What we felt back in November 2014, that's when I started thinking about digitizing payments and entire the payment, whatever, giving a different form to payments completely, or making payments formless, what I could call it as. That's when I started, and I started looking at various options and how we could go about with it. So when I just looked at it, a lot of challenges, not in terms of actually receiving payments. Receiving payments is just one, of course, is a very important component of it, and many of the technology guys have been doing it for several years now through payment gateways, which support cards as payment option, banking as payment option, and so on and so forth. But what we felt is that, okay, there is a need to create more forms of payment, or more mechanisms of payment, more to speak, to extend payment reach to merchants who can't afford card payments. Card payments are generally considered very expensive in the retail space and in the brick and mortar space. So I just looked at solving that problem. When I just went about looking at that, what we realized is that, okay, as with many marketplaces, it's actually a chicken and egg problem, right? No payment mechanism will kick off until there are people who are willing to pay with that, and no payment mechanism will kick off until there are people accepting that, right? It is a traditional chicken and egg problem. So my story today, the MVP story today that we are just talking about, is like, you know, taking one such chapter, okay, and how we went about actually solving that problem, okay, as a story of our journey, right? You know, in the sense, it's not the complete, it's not all encompassing story, but I just wanted to take a small piece of what Zeta has done so far, and how we went about iterating over it, and what are the various things that we learned at each stage, and to come to where we are today, right? That's what we're trying to do. So before I go in, I just want to show what Zeta is today, just a quick a minute on that. So for people who haven't seen or known about us, okay, I just want to quickly show you, this is this is the Zeta app. What you have is something what we call as a super card. It's pretty smart. I will not get into the details. It's not a marketing pitch anyway. So it has various mechanisms to make payments. You can just go to a store and send money to your friend, bank account. You can use what we call as a Zeta code, which is a nice 6-digit code. You can make payment with that. And you can just make payment to any store by just selecting the store and sending money to that store. Just quickly walk through, and you have in the Zeta app what we call as Zeta cloud cards. Okay, each of them represent various types of money, like, you know, this what you see as cash plus card out there is like your traditional debit card, or, you know, bank account, wherever you can just deposit money and take money out, or just use it like your Paytm wallet or whatever it is, a number of things that you can traditionally do with a bank account. And you have something called as a medical card, where your employee can actually deposit your medical allowance, and you can spend that, and there is tax incentives around that. I'm not going to the specific details. There is something called a fuel card. There is something called as a gift card, and number of other such things. Like, you know, in a typical, according to the Income Tax Act, there are 26 allowances that are available to salaried employees that they can claim tax benefits on. all of that is completely digitized and represented as what we call as cloud cards, okay? And whenever you're doing a transaction, Zeta is smart enough to understand where you are actually spending and accordingly use money that represents particular relevance that is applicable in that particular transaction. That is, like, if you're just paying at a medical store, it deducts money from your medical account so that you get the tax exemption for that, right? So when you're at a fuel outlet and if you have a fuel allowance and if you're making a payment at a fuel allowance, it automatically deducts money from your fuel card and just ensures that wherever, whenever you're transacting, whatever is the tax advantage you get, it is applicable and it is availed by you, right? And furthermore, what we have done is, like, you know, once I digitize all of these things, if I'm giving you a medical card and if there's money in the medical card, you should be able to directly buy medicines from it, right? So on and so forth, you will see that you can order medicines here and book a doctor appointment here and so on and so forth. And if you get a gift card, you should be able to use that gift on Amazon, KFC, whatever it is, various brands and various outlets. All of that is completely integrated. It just doesn't end there. Zeta has rewards program, XYZ other things, and it has what we call as, many of you might be familiar with Chrome Web Store. We have just integrated similar such store into the app so that you can just actually transact seamlessly and the checkout is taken care of by Zeta. That's an example, and we have integrated offers into it where these various offers from Coupon Dunia, whatever it is, all of that is just integrated into one place and you can just avail that. So whatever you are spending, whatever, even if a penny can be saved in that, we give you an option to save that through this. All of it, okay? So, but obviously the point I'm trying to make is, and it just doesn't end there, just to let you know, Zeta also has what we call as optimized all the entire tax benefits part of it. Spotlight is rewards and recognition, that is, like, whatever various gifts your employers can give and all that stuff. Express is for your cafeteria automation. We just completely automate the cafeteria payments with an NFC mode of payment through what we call a super tag. Anyway, it's a whole list of things. I just want to cut short there and just say that, okay, obviously, when I just tell you this, very pertinent question, is it minimum? It's far, far from it. I couldn't have started a product which says that, okay, it works like a Swiss Army knife with 50 things and 50 different ways of doing things and so on and so forth, right? People would reject me on the day one, or probably my business itself. There is nothing that I would have established as a value prop for my own business, okay? If I have to say that, I have to do this 50 things before I can launch my product, right? So there is practically no way I would have gone down this path. When I'm starting, it's definitely not minimal. Is it viable? Well, at the outset, if I just say that, okay, these are the 100 things put together, they make some sense, and all these 100 things put together will give you some value. Well, one can hardly say, you know, I don't know if it is viable, right? You cannot be sure that it's viable, right? And is it a product? Well, probably, but definitely not one product. We're talking about many products. This could be a suite of offerings, okay? So now, obviously, no startup that I know of should have tried this or should have started here, okay? And obviously, we too didn't start this. So it's definitely because it's not a minimum viable product, okay? Because we couldn't have gone to market with all of this and said that, okay, look, it works, or look, it doesn't work, okay? The amount of investment that's gone to building any such thing is quite high. So obviously, we couldn't have started here, right? Actually, we did. Okay, back in November 2014, when I just started looking at, you know, what we can do with digital payments, we realized that a lot could be done, and a lot could be done by actually creating more value on payment than the mere transaction. That is, when I'm just exchanging money with one person, the value of that should not be just exchanging money. Paper does that really well without any cost, without any friction, so to speak, okay? If something is digitized, the value should be much higher than that. That's a premise with which we have started, and there's a huge blueprint. This is the first mock that we prepared, by the way. The one that I'm showing is the first mock that we prepared back in December 2014, okay, where we said that, okay, if you are digitizing transactions, there should be more value. There are various sources of money that can be presented in one simplified form to the user. And then we said that, okay, there is a way to discover merchants, and you will be able to discover, identify the merchants, and you will be able to make transactions with them, so on and so forth. There are a whole lot of things that has gone into this blueprint before we even started, right? But obviously, I couldn't start that and go take the whole thing, build the whole thing, and go to market, right? What is the minimum product that I could actually take to the market and see if it is viable and see if I can just actually go on building thereafter? So the story is about how do you sell it the slice? How do you sell it the given the whole thing that you have in your mind, okay? How do you go about choosing the one slice that you can actually go ahead and put to market, test whether or not it's working, and iterate on top of it at that point in time? So we selected the first slice to be meal washers. Okay, you have, several of you have probably used these Sodexo meal washers, which are these paper washers that you take to you get from your employer, take to a retailer for and buy food with that. Okay, typically, right? So we selected that as the first slice. Now, how did we? I mean, given this whole blueprint of, you know, there are multiple sources of money and multiple ways of spending it, and there are retailers who have card reading machines, retailers who don't have card reading machines, and so on and so forth, all the complexity. How did we arrive at this particular thin slice? Okay, thin slice of, you know, choosing this one small thing called meal washers, right? Obviously, there are several tools for all of it. Like, you know, you do a lot of user surveys. You talk to several users, okay, because payments is just universal. You can just say, once I build a payment platform, you can do anything on top of it, right? So, but what is the use case that you would just go about picking? Obviously, there is some hypothesis that we came up with, okay? The fundamental thing that we said is, like, if I am solving a problem, it should solve at the highest pain possible, right? And provide the maximum value possible. So we took a survey among various types of audience. One, we went ahead and did a survey of college students and close environments, where we felt that, okay, we didn't have to solve the chicken and egg problem, or it is easy to solve the chicken and egg problem, where when you go to a closed environment, like a university campus, right? Okay, so solving the chicken and egg problem for the entire country is a much, much harder task than solving the problem in a university campus. So we went to a university campus, and just instead of giving the product out there, we just spoke to several merchants. We spoke to several students and spoke to them and asked them, you know, what are the problems that they have, and how do you think that the digital payments can solve the problem, okay? When I showed the first mocks, okay, to the merchants or the users, okay, users were completely ambivalent about it, okay, about, you know, okay, I don't care whether you give it or not, because they don't find it so painful, right? But when I just spoke to merchants about it, interestingly, they felt that, okay, the payment is not a big problem. Okay, I have enough number of alternatives. You know what? What you have shown in your mocks is that, okay, there is something called feed in the mock, the initial mock that I said. They said that, okay, my problem is, what I see as value is that, okay, you're not really solving a problem, but what I see as a value is that I can actually reach out to my customers through your app, okay? What I like is the channel of advertising that you got there called feed, okay? So payments is not my problem, okay? So that's the first thing that I actually, a very interesting insight that we got when we felt that, okay, change is a big problem in colleges. Like people, if you just actually look at a typical student behavior, again, learned from the survey, they do a 200 rupee cash withdrawal almost every day. They're super expensive people for banks, okay? So there are people who actually do ATM withdrawals 4 times a week, right, in college campuses. These are all the insights that we got when we just looked at it. So we felt like, okay, this is not the audience, okay? This is not a payment problem that we will be solving, okay? So we didn't even build the product. We just stopped from there. So when we just came to another setup, okay, we did try 2 other setups. When I came to the another setup, when we started speaking to the HR, okay, what we realized when we started speaking to the corporates, what we realized is there's a huge pain in handling that paper. Okay, this is like a treasury job to get those vouchers, stock them and give them to the employees and so on and so forth. There's a huge pain there. When we started talking to the employees, incidentally HR also happens to be employees of the organization who are also availing those benefits. When we started talking to them, they felt that, okay, this is even bigger pain to start using those vouchers and so on and so forth. So we felt like, okay, fine, indicatively there's a big problem here. Let's try solving it. I'm not going to get into, again, technical details of, you know, what exactly is the solution realm looking, is supposed to be modeled as. But let's say we pick this slice, okay? So now once we started talking to the people, we could clearly see that, okay, they are able to articulate the problem. In many cases, when we start try to solve the problem, often we give an excuse that, okay, the problem is latent. Okay, I do it several times, okay? When I have a theory to say that, okay, this will work, okay? And if someone says that, no, I don't think it may not work, or I don't see that people are actively looking at a solution for this, the excuse that I often give to several of my friends or people involved in the product development is the pain is latent. They don't realize it. Once you just give an alternative solution to it, they start realizing it, okay? Yes, it is true. In several cases, it would be so. But you know, once you identify a problem that people can actually articulate, okay, people can actually articulate, that's I think is a good place to start from. Okay, if you can identify such a problem, that's a good place to start. So that's a good problem to solve. So we said, okay, the thinnest slice that we could just, okay, the first picture that I showed you had lots of features, and the product that I showed as a initial product has several things in it. But this is the very first slice that we started off with. This is the first, very first mock, and this is the first slice we started giving out to people, okay? So very simple thing. You have a text box where you can type in 6 digits, or you know, you can just search by name, and we'll give you a list of merchants that are nearby, okay? You can tap that merchant and enter the amount and make a payment. Enter the amount and say pay. The payment is complete. Unfortunately, I don't have that version right now. Otherwise, I would have shown. These are just about 5 screens. That's all. This was January. By January, of 2015. Okay. January of. This is not January. This is July of 2015. Okay. July of 2015. No, not really. In this slice, yes. Okay, today Zeta can be used to make payments anywhere across the world. Okay, but the very first slice we picked, as I said, like payments is universal. It's a very, very broad thing. The very first slice that we said is like, okay, you're going to get a list of merchants where you can make a payment. Okay, and you will select a merchant, just enter the value that you can make payment. Enter the value that you want to pay and just say pay, you'll get that receipt that the payment is done, okay? As simple as that. That's what we did, right, as the very first slice. And this is, as I said, like in July of 2015, that is like we started in April 2015. Zeta started, our first team was recruited in April 2015. July 2015, we are ready with this product, and I remember that date because, like, July 28th of 2015 is NASSCOM HR conference. Okay, so we presented this there. Okay, so this is just the simplest thing that we presented. Now, obviously, very thin slice, nothing too much to invent, nothing there to brag about it. But so simple, done, shipped, and I don't know how many of you are aware of this quote, okay? Nothing survives contacting the customer for the first time. Nothing that you thought survives. It's the simplest thing. It's solving a big pain. I have already validated the pain with my customer, right? Okay, they're very, very clear in their articulation that there's the biggest pain that they are handling month on month, not like, you know, from a HR perspective, and from a user perspective, they're handling it like every single day, okay? So it's a big pain that I'm solving. Okay, but what could go wrong, right? So when I just went ahead, all these shiny faces, okay, this is the part of the initial team that we had. It was the NASCOM HR booth out there in the backdrop, okay? And we have several people from HR fraternity who came and said, like, we love what you guys are doing. It's brilliant. I mean, we didn't expect that, okay, it can be digitized this way, so on and so forth. Okay, it's all great. But what turned out to be is, like, they're just asking one question, right? But where can I use this? Okay, but where can I use this? Obviously, I couldn't have gone there without an answer for that question. My answer has been that, okay, if you confirm, okay, within 30 days, or if you say that, okay, you want to try, if you as a company want to try, within 30 days, I'll convert all the merchants in your vicinity to start accepting Zeta payments. Okay, I thought, like, it's a very, very valid, viable answer. Okay, you should be convinced, because I told you that, okay, this is in 30 days, I'll definitely convert. And obviously, you're not paying anything to me, and everything is fine. You should just try it out. Okay, not even one said they will give it a shot. Okay, first find an answer for this, then we'll look at it. Okay, it's solving a big pain, and they have all the incentive to try it out, because I'm saying that I'm going to charge you nothing. Okay, there is no cost in adoption. Still, they don't want to do that, right? Yes, fortunately, we are part of Direct Tie group with about 1,200 people back then. This, before we went to NASCOM Summit, people were already using it within our cafeteria for making the payments and so on and so forth. Okay. So we spoke to merchants. Okay, what gave us confidence is we spoke to merchants. We showed them the thing. So the biggest factor, again, for the merchant side of the story, is, like, the meal washer companies like Sodexo, Edenred, and other guys. They charge merchant close to 4%. Okay, depending on the size of the merchant and nature of the business, they charge 4 to 7% of the transaction value as their fee. Okay, and merchants take these papers. They have to submit to the respective companies, and they get the payment back in 45 days. Okay, that's like another 1% lost in the working capital cost. Okay, so the net cost of payment for a merchant is 5 to 7%, and I was giving the merchant at zero price. Okay, so he's so excited. I mean, the merchant, we never had a problem with the merchant. Well, we had certain problems. I'll talk about it. From a model and trying perspective, merchant never said, I won't try. Okay, so he's fine, just bring me the users. So the merchant has always given us the assurance that if you bring me the users, why would I say no to it? Just go get it. So we had that confidence from the merchant side of the story. And also, what we are asking from the merchant is nothing. This, all that I showed is on the user side. On the merchant side, he doesn't even need to have a smartphone, or he doesn't need to have anything digital. Just a simple phone would work. Okay, so that's how we built this solution. We just simplified everything for the merchant. But coming back to the user side of the things, okay, we felt that, okay, this is a very viable thing when I'm just talking to the HR to try it out. Okay, obviously nobody was willing to try. Okay, so we had to abandon the entire approach and start looking at what we could do with the merchant. Okay, obviously we have the important problem, what we thought as a chicken and egg, okay, is, and we are going to solve the problem, is not solved. So we just picked up next slice. We said that, okay, how can we just make it completely oblivious, or, you know, make the merchant network redundant itself? Okay, one problem is to eliminate the problem itself. Like, one solution to the problem is eliminate the problem itself. If people are asking for merchant network, why can't I just eliminate the need for merchant network? Okay, no, why should there be a merchant network, so to speak? So what we said is, like, okay, well, let's give it a complete spin. Okay, there is a thing, like, okay, whenever the user has spent on meal, ask him to just upload a bill. Okay, just ask him to select the merchant where he has spent that money. Ask him to upload the bill. We will validate. Of course, it's a very difficult thing. It's not a viable thing, but it's definitely a minimal thing that I could just start off with, because one of the theories of doing a startup is like, don't worry about viability in the beginning. So that's a lesson, that's a theory I was subscribing to back then. So just try if it works, right? Okay, try if it works. So we just went ahead and just said that, okay, forget about everything else. Let your employees go and spend, let them upload the bill. We will validate and verify that it is actually a food spend. In that case, we'll just convert that meal money. If it is a food spend, we'll convert that meal money into their regular cash and they can transfer it to their bank account. Okay, very, very simple from that perspective, right? You just, I don't know how, I mean, like, you see this, right? You don't have to have a much a network, so to speak. Okay, wherever your employees goes to, let's say, for example, my pitch to the HR is, wherever your employee goes to, he will just simply, after making a payment, take a picture of the bill and claim his allowance on that particular spend. Take a picture and claim his allowance on that particular spend. Very straightforward, okay? So, yes, this time I saw some conversion, okay, in terms of like, okay, there are about less than 1%, but at least some people have converted and started adopting this. Obviously, it further couldn't continue because the competition cried foul about it. Okay, they started saying that, okay, no, this is not how meal should be implemented as an allowance and so on and so forth. Again, there is a whole legal story around that. I'm not going to get into that. So what we felt as a really simple shortcut, a hack, to bringing out a product and saying that, okay, we cut off all the dependencies that need to be that are traditionally assumed, right? We thought like it's a very powerful hack that we came up with. We just completely abandoned the chicken and egg. Again, going back to the chicken and egg problem, we completely abandoned one side of the story and we should be able to roll it out, but it didn't happen that way, right? Again, this is a learning from the market. So we still had to solve the chicken and egg problem, so we adopted the brute force approach. That is, okay, fine, I'm not able to get the customer, let me get the merchant, because there's a lot of readiness from the merchant perspective, okay? So we use brute force. It's not a product per se, a product technology problem that we are solving here, but we use brute force to actually approach the merchants, right? So when we approach the merchants, as you would expect, when I say I'm giving it for free, they will all say, yes, awesome, give it for me for free, right? After a week, they will forget about the product because there is no customer coming and asking for it. Okay, just 1 week after, if I go and say that, okay, do you accept Zeta? What is Zeta? Okay, and more importantly, what happens is that, okay, at the store, there are in a family-run store, there are probably 3 or 4 people at the counter at different points in time. Okay, in a large retail store, it's a completely different story. Okay, the churn rate is close to 20% month on month, the people who are operating the cash counters. Okay, so this is a huge training cost when you had to give a solution. These are all not factors that we have considered when we proposed this solution. This is just like we said that, okay, there is no technology cost that's out there for the merchant. Okay, he should be able to start accepting it. So again, while we tried using brute force, there are big things. Our solution was rejected because, you know, in all these large format places, they couldn't change, like, let's say you go to Big Bazaar to accept a payment, they have to change their POS machines and they have to train lots of people, which are the factors that we haven't considered, is grossly rejected by them, right? And so therefore, we had to go back to the drawing board again, okay? So the solution we had to look at is like, you know, again, this is the same problem. How do you go about looking at it? Ideally, you know, at this point in time, we could have pivoted into some other problem, okay? But what we know is that the problem is very valuable, right? Problem was stated, articulated by all the people as a pain, right? And people can see that, okay, if we solve the problem, there will be an adoption of it. Now, how do you go about solving it? So all these iterations are about that. And when I'm just looking at each of these things, at every point in time, what we tried doing is do the least and take it out, and all the things that I said so far were rejected. At any point in time when I started looking at it, I felt like I have a really awesome solution. It's the simplest form in which that particular problem could have been solved, but it was simply rejected the moment I gave it to the customer, right? So there is another such story, because, you know, as you see, the product is nowhere what you're seeing right now. So another such story, the simplest thing is, okay, if we are not able to build a merchant network, leverage the existing merchant network. Visa, MasterCard, RuPay, these guys represent a huge merchant network. Okay, leverage an existing merchant network. Now, how do you go about doing that? You can simply go and issue a card to every person who is making a payment, right? That's a very simple way of doing it. Every bank does that. So, but we did a spin on that. Why? Because we thought it's even more simpler to give a card to a merchant. Now, imagine, okay, a scenario where you're going to a merchant and he has a card, okay? When you go walk to his shop and say that I want to make a payment, okay? You say that he asks how much, I mean, like whatever the transaction happens, and you're saying that I will make a payment of 200 rupees, and he is taking his card, swiping it, entering 200 rupees, and asking you for a PIN, and he gets 200 rupees. You didn't give him anything, right? So, I'll give it one more stab of explaining it, explanation. So this is what we called as collect card, right? The collect card is something, a card that user will not have, the person collecting money will have. That is, the merchant will have the collect card, okay? He will swipe on the regular card reading machine, right? And enter the money that you would have wanted to make a payment, right? You know, 400 rupees, let's say. He enters the 400 rupees, and just to take that money from you, he asks you for a PIN. You give him a PIN, he enters that PIN, and he gets the 400 rupees, right? This is a kind of a tech spin that we just did on the card, where we said that people don't even have to carry cards. You just have a mobile that's sufficient to make a payment, okay? So we felt like, you know, it's one of the best inventions on the card payment systems. We patented it duly, and we said that, okay, it's going to be welcomed with open arms by everybody, okay? Because instead of investing on a card per person, you flipped it. One merchant will have one card. That's all it takes to make money, to transfer money, okay? So the same first version that I showed, it works for this mechanism. You just go find a shop, make a payment, you get the transaction code. That's the PIN. Okay? So the merchant takes the orange color collect card that he has in his pocket, he swipes, enters the PIN, and that's all. He got 682 rupees into his bank account. I'm sorry? What kind of danger, sir? Not really. So this PIN will work for that 682 rupees at that particular merchant for a brief period of 2 minutes. So I mean, like, okay, so I'm not talking about the tech here. Just, okay, whatever we have done, right, you know, assume that, okay, the hygiene factors are taken care of. Okay, so what we are given is that, okay, this is the solution, and eureka moments, okay, and we just went about. Yes. This is the customer app, okay? You just indicated that you want to pay to Subway 682 rupees on your app, and we gave you a PIN for that particular transaction. That's all you have. Yes, merchant swipes his card, enters 682 rupees is what he wants to collect, okay, and asks you for the PIN. That's all, I'm sorry? That's all Zeta does that. Okay, Zeta knows that, okay, who the merchant is and everything, because the card. Yeah, the we know that because, you know, when the merchant is swiping on his machine, we know the machine from which the transaction is coming to us, and we also know we gave the collect card. The card is given by Zeta. Okay. Okay, so yeah, so let's yeah. So the point is, okay, yeah. That's thanks for reminding about time. Yes. So the point is, it's a net. Okay, ignore the magic part of it or the smartness part of the solution, okay? But obviously, it just seemed like a something contra, something that just eliminates lots of hops in the equation. Anybody can just download Zeta app and go to any merchant and make a payment, whether or not that merchant has a certain kind of a specific instruments for us, because all he needs is a 15, 20 rupee plastic to collect money, right? The entire merchant network, which is currently accepting MasterCard, is our merchant network. Just all I needed to do was give a plastic to them. We said it's a brilliant solution. We went to merchants, they really loved it and all that stuff. Okay, boom. Something must have gone wrong, right? Okay, so it did go wrong. The problem was that when we gave this interface, I remember this specific store more, okay? He said, like, what nuts are you? I mean, like, where did you come from? Okay, it's all fine, whatever theory that you're giving. You think my average household wife who buys grocery at my outlet, okay, do you think she is going to just come here, open the app, enter the merchant name more, okay, and she will be online while she's doing that, enter the merchant name more and enter the digits and finally give me this digits, right? You must be on pot or whatever it is, right? Okay, that's the thing. So we had to go back to drawing board. It was rejected by large merchants. The small merchants were okay with that. Okay, they didn't have too much. I mean, they are also like, you know, first time when they heard that, okay, they are in awe, and you know, more often than not, all our sales visit convert because they're surprised that something like this could happen. But when it came to large merchants, they completely rejected the solution. Okay, it's just about keeping a card at the till. That was fine, but they said that their customers will never do that, or the majority of the customers will never do that. So we had to go back again and redo the whole thing. Okay, so with one concept this time, where all you require to give is digits. Okay, why do you need to go make the user do all the steps that we were doing? So we just completely cut them off and brought down to this. The entire app, we just removed everything. What you would see on the app is just one circle. You tap and hold that circle, it gives 6 digits, and that's your PIN. Right? You just, instead of the 4 digits that you have received after 3 steps, right? We tap and hold the circle, and you get this 6 digits, and the payment is done. Right now, this is probably the simplest payments have ever happened. And you would see on our app also till today, this is the mechanism that is in use by several of our customers as on today. Sorry. Obviously, the app went through a lot of journey. That's all you do. You just go and give these 6 digits. You tap and hold. You go and give these 6 digits. The merchant will get money from you. Yeah, but you know, it's also an identifier, not only an authenticator. There is a lot of science that has gone into it. We are not talking about that. What I'm saying, what my intent to say here is that, you know, whatever we thought is simple, there is much simpler version there. Okay, we never discovered it. Okay, and each time we thought we had a clever move that would solve the problem. Okay, it was clever. But when the customer sees it, it just seemed to him like a trick or something that just indicated that, okay, we reflected to him that our ignorance of the customer, his customer rather, okay, when I went to him. Okay, so many iterations which I would have traditionally considered as simple things, like, you know, what big deal is it to select a merchant and make a payment? They were rejected by the customer. The simplest things I thought are easy to execute, they were all rejected. When we iterated on it, we never would have thought in our head that a payment could be just brought down to sharing those digits, right? Until we were just pushed to that extreme limit to a point where they said that, okay, no, we can't accept this. And each iteration, we have just, what we thought as a minimal thing that we started off with, at each iteration, we just stripped off so many things to come down to this one payment method, which would work, and no one could argue. There is no And by the way, this code works even if you're not connected to internet and all that stuff. So there is all those, again, hygiene factors out there. It is just completely brought down to a level where anybody who is even moderately literate, okay, understands digits, and he should be able to make a payment. That's the level to which we were pushed by our customers, and we couldn't have arrived at it in one go. So this is like the number of iterations. Thank you. I'm sorry? Yes, that's as I said, this is not the end story. The journey is much longer. We went through a lot more iterations and lot many more things. Yeah, that's great. Thank you. But yes, we call that as a supercard. Now, when that's a different aspect. Okay, the journey didn't end here. Okay, so this is but what actually gave us the maximum acceptance. Okay, so when we just gave this, nobody had, so to speak, any objections thereafter. So there is a lot of adoption in this phase, but we moved on to issuing cards subsequently. I'm sorry? Without showing what, sir? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I don't have a problem with that, actually. So the point is, you can do that even today, right? Okay, you can go to a guy and just say that, okay, you can give a band of cash. He takes a band of cash and record the sale. About what? Why is that? Not really, sir. I don't think so. So, anyway, yeah. Any questions? Any comments? There is a flip, okay. Paytm QR code is used to identify the merchant, okay, and after that you push money to the merchant. That's pretty much the first flow that we did, okay, the three screen flow, where you select the merchant, either through, you use a QR code to help you in identifying that merchant, or you got a list and you select a merchant from there, and after that the payment is done, okay. That's that, okay, and it has several dependencies. For example, firstly, the user should be, the biggest hurdle is that the user should be able to do that action itself, scan the QR code and do that. There are several limitations with respect to QR codes. In all this, we have done QR codes. There are several experiments that have gone that I haven't been talking about. There are hundreds of them, actually. The problem with QR code is like, it doesn't work in several light conditions, okay? And it depends on line of sight. Your camera need to be, you know, depending on where the QR code is and all the stuff, it doesn't work at a wide scale. So we just removed all of it to just bring it into digits that can be communicated, that can be shown, and has very limited dependencies in the physical, on the physical medium. Yep. Yes, that's another important aspect. We always solve the problem with an assumption that the user doesn't have internet. In all the things that I spoke and shown you, user didn't have to have internet. Yes. Yeah. So traditionally, all merchant payments rely on one business model, which is merchant pays. Okay. There are more elements to it. There is money always. When people are parking money, there is money always in that. Okay, that's typically referred to as float. So there is a float revenue always when you're keeping money in your savings account. There is a float revenue in it. There are typically, it is classified into multiple models. There is a financial revenue, there is a transactional revenue, and we don't have much of it, but traditional players also talk about breakage revenue. That is like people put money and forget about it. So, So a lot of it is about user service. That's the first thing. And we, our product team, the way we structure it is there is a pre and post. There is a product manager, and he has two associate product managers who will talk about pre-product release and who will talk about post-product release. Any particular feature when it is picked, okay, there is one guy who is looking at what all need to be in the product even before we just actually go and put it to any user. Okay, that's one aspect that we take care of, the elaborate list. And that, while the product is being built, there is a post-product manager who actually goes ahead and looks at the feature. What are the various things that I need to check to know whether or not this is actually working, okay, from the time I started rolling it out? And we have this various mechanisms to do staggered rollout. Okay, we don't just simply rely on the app stores. We have higher level controls. So we control the visibility of feature each time when I'm just giving an iteration. The visibility is completely controlled. We do a staggered rollout. And the post product manager actually looks at, you know, whether or not people are behaving in the anticipated way or not. Okay, that's one aspect. But that's now where we have some scale. In the initial days, it's the hard work. You just have to go talk to the user, see him how he is using it, see the merchant how he is using it, so on and so forth. That's okay, sorry. Yeah. Sure.